I wish I'd given Whale a miss. But I was only three, at a picnic on a Dorset beach.
I am wailing very soft, Mum.
It would have been discourteous to refuse the lumps of grey gelatinous meat beneath an undercooked pastry crust. It was like chewing in a razor.
Harpoon sharpen, did cabin bees win?
This whaling station was operational from 1904 till a few years after the Second World War. Whales were processed for ambergris, for oil and wax, and for margarine, which explains a lot. The meat, cheap, plentiful, unpleasant, was a staple part of the islanders' diet. A lot of food is still produced here, but much of it is beyond the inhabitants' means. Scallops, lobster, crayfish, mussels, and so on. But not salmon, which is so intensively farmed that its price has plummeted along with its quality. The locks are factories. And like factories, they manifest what might be called an industrial style. Though that's pushing it a bit. Sub-utilitarian is more like it. Herrings and salmon are kippered. Salmon is also cold-smoked and cured as gravlax. Highland cattle, crowdy cheese, beef, sheep, lamb, hogget, wether, tweed, not a food, MacLeod and MacLeod, Charles MacLeod, W.J. MacDonald, A.R. Morrison, A. France. All of these butchers make the best, the truly original, the most authentic Stornoway black pudding, Maracou. It is the peer of the best Blutwurst, Boudin Noir and Mothia. It can sit at the top table and hold its own.
This toy fortress was designed in 1848 for Sir James Matheson. It's in a style that a plutocrat might have chosen 25 years earlier, long before Victoria's accession. Which isn't surprising, for Matheson had been out east all of that time. He was a trader, which is to say, he was a drug dealer. A drug dealer on a heroic scale, which Columbia's finest can only look on with envious wonder.
This God-fearing teetotaler bought the entire island with a fortune made from transporting opium from India to China and from promoting addictive dependence in tens of thousands of people in southern China.
It was on behalf of Matheson and his fellow dealers when they were expelled by the Chinese government that Britain waged the ignominious opium wars. Matheson should have been imprisoned. Instead, he received a baronetcy, and like many criminals before and since, was elected to Parliament, whereupon he proposed that a grim lump of rock to the north of here, called Rona, should be turned into a high-security prison.
He built his castle on the site of the island's only distillery, thus encouraging the use of illicit stills.
Whilst the castle, despite its size, is rather trivial, its remarkable grounds demonstrate that parks, aviaries, zoos and arboreta were, despite their association with the Enlightenment's propagation of knowledge, founded by men trying to play at God, trying to mimic what was still widely considered to be his creation. They belong sentimentally to an age before reason.
Or at least to an age before humility and reason told man that he was no more capable of controlling the world than a god had been
of having created it. In Matheson's native northern highlands, the clearances of crofters had been undertaken by landowners and clan chiefs in what they believed, or at least deluded themselves, was a spirit of philanthropic noblesse oblige. The so-called improvements were as much a project of Enlightenment pedagogy as of agrarian capitalism. People who subsisted in insanitary bothies, burrows and caves were forcibly removed from the land which hardly yielded them a living.
You're a thousand miles away, but I still have your love to remember you by.
Oh my darling. Some were provided with houses, jobs and education in the new grid-plan fisher towns of the Sutherland and Caithness coasts. Some were transported across the Atlantic. The moors they had inhabited were made over to sheep.
On my knees every day.
By the mid-19th century, all philanthropic pretense had been abandoned. Matheson proceeded to treat the islanders, his islanders, with the same sensitivity that he had displayed in Canton, though they were not provided with the balmy solace of narcosis. Nor did he build a fisher town. In the early years of the 1850s, almost 2,000 inhabitants were forcibly expatriated, mostly to Canada, their passage paid by Matheson. The suppression of whiskey had been calculated. The suppression of Gaelic was, in part, a clumsy consequence of this involuntary diaspora. What Matheson did do was build roads. They provided work during the famine years of the 1840s. He intended that they should be used to carry peat so that it might be transformed into tar. The scheme was a non-starter. On the mainland, such roads came to be known as destitution roads because they were built by the destitute, and it was along them that the indigent marched away from destitution to their uncertain future on the other side of the world. The name is prescient. Today they often lead to a different sort of destitution. Whatever wealth is generated is mostly well concealed. It is very seldom manifest in the built environment. And when it is, there are some works of architectural merit on the island. Well, a few. And they seem impertinently pretentious, measured against the startlingly abject norm. This is perhaps the only place in the world whose townships and villagescapes, urbanism and landscapes, are wholly infected by the Calvinist mentality. That is, by a blindness to prettification, by an aesthetic bereavement so absolute that it is a sort of insouciant anti-aesthetic. In a way, the everyday buildings are the very contrary of Matheson's. They suggest that to compete with this most magnificent terrain would be both hubristic and certain failure. So they simply didn't bother to compete. The unsurpassable strangeness of the island resides in the chasmic gulf between the naturally evolved and the negligently created, between scarp and scrap, between the sublime and the substandard. Not that the natural is invariably natural. It generally isn't. The landscape most formed by man here is not that of menhirs and dolmens. In fact, man is moot in this context. This corrugated pattern of drainage furrows, runs, and fertile ridges, rigs, is mostly in desuetude. But it's so widespread that it's one of the defining characteristics of the landscape. These systems, like stone circles, possess the kind of abstract integrity that often attaches to the purely practical.